There is a certain peace that comes over me when someone comes up to me and says, I hear that so-and-so is going on. Do you know, as far as activities, do you know anything about it? And I say, no, I don't. That gives me a lot of peace. See, I've decided that the more you know, the more responsibility you have for what you know. And if I don't know what's happening, if I don't know the details of all the things that are happening here, then I don't have any responsibility. And I can say, I don't know, but I can tell you who does know. And I can send you off to go and see them. I think that's something that's very enjoyable. I take pride in some things that I don't know. At the same time, I have to admit, I know things I wish I did not know. We're all that way, right? We all know things, and we wish we didn't know them. And so I look at Paul's words in this passage, and I'm thinking, I like this. I'm drawn to these words where Paul said, I determined not to know anything among you. I like that. And then I read in chapter 4 and in verse 16 of 1 Corinthians, he says, imitate me. And so I feel justified when I go in there and I say, Paul told me not to know, so I don't know. Well, is that really what's going on? In our congregational Bible reading, we're in this past week, we read the first four chapters of 1 Corinthians as we're reading the epistles of Paul to the churches. Starting today, you can begin in chapter 5 and go through chapter 8. And we're using these texts for sermons and ideas, especially if there are things that jump out of the text from you, I'd love to hear them. But notice with me, if you will, this idea that Paul says, I have determined not to know anything among you. I want to give you a little better, more accurate structure of that part of the verse. And I think that when you see it, maybe you'll be able to understand maybe a little better as we walk through what he is actually saying. Here's what the verse, more accurately constructed, probably says. I have not determined to know anything among you. Now, as the Bible scholars that I was reading said, the word not is supposed to be connected to the determination, not to the knowledge. It says the same thing, both in how I see it worded in the New King James and how this other rendering is. But I like how it says, I have not determined to know anything among you. And he goes on to say, except for Jesus Christ and him crucified. There are two important words in this phrase. Number one, determined. The word in the Greek is krino, and it means to judge or to think good of something. As the Greek scholar Gresham Thayer said, it means that you choose or separate between things. What's Paul saying? Paul said, okay, here's the idea. I am making a judgment. I am separating things into their proper categories. The basis then of this word for determination is a word that means to separate. So when a person determines something, you put this in this category because that's where it belongs. And you put this in this category because that's where it belongs. And you do the same thing over here. And what you don't do is you don't take this and move it over here into this, or this and move it over here to this section, because it doesn't fit. It would be separated improperly. Now that same kind of idea occurs in the New Testament. When Paul made this statement, he said, rightly dividing the word of truth. That's the same idea. What that means is you separate things into their proper category. There are some things that are confined to what we call the Old Testament, the Old Covenant. And there are other things that are in the New Covenant. And we don't take things that belong exclusively to one or the other and put it in the wrong category. He says, rightly dividing, making separations, making choices based upon separating things into their proper category. That's the word determination. Number two, Paul said, I have determined not to know, or I've not determined to know. Now the word know, in this particular case, the word eido, is a word that means to remember, to have it in your mind. As one scholar said, it refers to the possession of knowledge. Another one defined it this way. If you are researching and looking for information, that's the type of knowledge described by the word in Greek, ginosko, meaning I'm searching, I'm looking, I'm wanting to know. But this word, eido, is a word that means now that I have assembled all the facts, here is all of the knowledge, now I understand. Now I get it. In fact, the word eido is related to the word I see. So when someone says, do you get it? And they say, I see that. It doesn't mean necessarily they saw anything with their eyes, but they saw it with their mind's eye. They were able to put together all of the information and to come up with a conclusion. I understand. That's the meaning of this word. So what Paul is saying is there are things, he's talking about his knowledge, but the retaining of the knowledge and therefore what's going on with it. Now let's ask the question. So what does all of that mean? Well, number one, here's what it does not mean. It does not mean that Paul said, I don't either have or want to have any knowledge or facts about anything in your lives. That's not what Paul was saying to the Corinthians. The truth of the matter is, Paul had a whole lot of facts about the Corinthians. As you read through the book of 1 Corinthians, it helps to know what's going on in order to understand the construction of the book. Paul spent quite a bit of time in Corinth, both in his time there and after he left. He had learned a whole lot of things about the church in Corinth, and he writes about it in the book of 1 Corinthians. Just start walking through the book. First thing we learn is they were fighting amongst themselves about who had the better spiritual genealogy. Well, Paul baptized me. Cephas, Peter, baptized me. And they were fighting over their spiritual genealogy. And Paul said, stop it. This was a divided people. In chapter 1, verse 10, speak the same things. Be joined together in the same heart and the same judgment. The whole book is dedicated to the divisions that Paul knew about in the church at Corinth. And they related to this fight over spiritual genealogy. Number two, in chapter 2, it seems like they were not really sure that the apostles were speaking from God. And Paul has to write and say, listen, wait a minute. We've received the words God wanted us to give. We weren't just giving our own thoughts. There was some discussion about that. If you go over in chapters 3 and 4, there's some sectarian spirit that is developing, the wisdom of the world and the wisdom of God. In chapter 5, we have a situation where there was a man in the congregation who was in a sexual relationship with his own stepmother. And the church was happy about it and glorying in it. And Paul said, stop it. You got to quit. In chapter 6, he found out that this is a church where there are brethren suing each other. They're taking each other to court, in open court, airing their differences. In chapter 7, they didn't understand marriage well at all, and they were fighting over, but I think this was a little different situation. I mean, admittedly, it was a unique situation. Here are people who have been married for many years, and then the gospel is preached, and one of them obeys and the other does not. Paul, what am I supposed to do? Am I supposed to stay in this marriage where this person's not a Christian? And Paul says, yes. If they want to stay, stay. Don't. You can teach them. Now, if they want to leave, you can't stop them. But you have to stay connected to God. You have to remain a Christian. In chapter 8, they're fighting about things related to, can we eat meat that somebody else sacrificed to an idol god? Can we actually buy that meat and he tell us, now I sacrificed this to my idol god, so that's why it's already cooked. And you go, well, I can't eat that. Because Paul says, think about your conscience and the conscience of your brother. In chapter 9, they're not even sure Paul is an apostle. And he has to defend himself. In chapter 11, they're fighting over, should a woman who's a Christian, who becomes a Christian, can she now take off her veil? Does that free her from wearing the veil? And then they're having this conflict about the Lord's Supper during worship. And then there's the conflict over who has the better spiritual gift in chapters 12, 13, and 14. And in 15, they're not even sure about the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. And are we therefore going to rise? Paul knew a whole lot about the church at Corinth. Therefore, when he said, I've not determined to know anything, it doesn't mean that he had no desire to know what was going on in Corinth, because he did. He knew it. But what he's saying is this: I don't want to possess that knowledge and allow that knowledge to change how I react with you when the most important thing to know is whether you're with Jesus or you're not. Now, yes, I know Paul made statements about all of these things they disagreed about, and he told them what the truth of it was, but it did not change how he interacted with them. Here's my question. Let's look at it from this standpoint. Look at all those things that I just said about the church in Corinth. you're back in the first century. And you have a chance to move to Corinth. And the first thing you want to do, which we ought to do continually, you go and visit the church at Corinth to find out this church, because this is where we're going to live, and we need to know if this is where we want to be. And all of a sudden, you find this letter that Paul wrote about Corinth, and you read it and you go, whoa, I'm not going to that church. I think that's what Paul's saying. Paul went to that church. Paul was a part of that church. And he interacted with those people. What I think he's saying is, yes, there are things that are right and wrong. We have to stand up for what's right and oppose what is wrong. But there are certain things that are number one in importance, and that is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I need to look at you, and you need to look at me through the lens of Jesus and Him crucified, not through the lenses of the negative things you know about me and I know about you. Because we all have those things. Let's be very practical. Let's put a practical understanding to this verse. And I think what Joe said this morning is exactly right. I think this verse sums it up. It really does. And it helps us to be able, when we get it, to interact as a congregation and to interact as individual Christians with each other. Here's the first thing that it means. It means that primarily I am going to be concerned about your spiritual growth, your spiritual life, not your physical. There are a lot of things that happen in life that are great and wonderful, and I should be happy about those, and you should be happy about those, and we ought to talk about those. Yes, I understand that, but the most important thing is, are you a child of God? Are you on your spiritual journey? Are you spiritually where you need to be? If we're really quick to help someone in financial difficulty, that's okay. If we really want to help somebody struggling mentally with the problems of life, absolutely. If we're all about fixing and helping marriages, if we're all about raising godly teenagers, if we're all about taking care of the needs of widows and orphans, all of that is good. But if we never get around to understanding a spiritual condition, there's a problem. That ought to be the thing upon which we base everything we do, is spiritual condition. Number two, it means, as Paul said, I'm not just going to concern myself with small talk. We can spend a lot of time small talking. We really can. And you know, there's nothing wrong with small talk. There's nothing wrong with the mundane things of what's happening with your children in school and in sports, and how you doing on your job, and are you enjoying the house you live in, and how about your neighbors, and we talk about what about your goals, and are you doing well in retirement? Those are all good. But that's just small talk compared to what is big talk, and that is, we are Christians. And how is that relationship going? Number three, Paul was saying, I want to operate from the principle that says every single person is a child of God. And I want to see you through that lens. I'm often amazed in the types of dramas or things that I enjoy being a part of in television, in the crime dramas, and I love watching when the resolution happens and a court decision is made. And my favorite time is when they give an opportunity for families who've been victimized to confront the one who's done the deed. And when they say victim impact statements and they talk about all the terrible, hard things that have happened because of you, and that's all true, then they look at them and say, I want you to know that I forgive you. And I hope you grow and move past it. That's what I'm talking about. That's this. Because the worst criminal is a child of God. God made that person. And I guarantee you, God is grieved by the sinful actions of people. Are we? I'm not talking about, are we disgusted with the action? We are. My question is, are we grieved that that person is caught up in it to the point that we'd like to get them out? Fourth, I think Paul was saying, I'm not going to take pride and joy in detrimental thoughts about you. You know what the heart of gossip is? The heart of gossip is taking joy in the misfortunes of somebody else. The heart of that kind of activity means, oh, that's some juicy material, and I like holding on to that juicy material. This is really fun. Paul says, I'm not going to do that. There's plenty of juicy material in Corinth. But he said, I'm not taking pride in it. I don't joy in it. This doesn't make me feel good. I don't want to think about that. I want to think about this. Therefore, he's saying, finally, in the future, and as I deal with you, I only want to think of you not through the negative things I know, but through the fact that we're children of God and we're on the same path. Here's what Paul was saying. I made this judgment. I made this call. I determined this. Not that I'm going to go seek out all this information and hold it and take pride in it and use it every now and then. I didn't do that. I didn't determine to do that. What I determined was this. What I'm going to hold in my knowledge about you, what I'm going to possess in my thoughts about you, are the things related to the fact that we are children of God together. We've all sinned. We've all got problems. There are negative things about all of us, but we're all moving in the same direction. I want to be better, therefore I want you to be better. I expect to be better, therefore I think you can be better. And when we work with each other that way, then we won't get caught up in the kinds of problems that the world constantly is involved with libel, slander, gossip, deceit. Paul was right. Let every one of us determine not to know that way, but rather to know this way. You're my brother. You're my sister. Let us live and work together, knowing that that is who we are. And when we do, there's only one way, and that's up. Today, if you're not a child of God and you want to be a part of that family, we want you to be. That's what we really desire. is to have family relationships. You can be born into the family of God today. Based on your repentance, you can be baptized into Jesus Christ and become a new child of God. But today, if any one of us needs a family to reach out and to help in certain difficulties, we're here for you if you'll come as we stand and sing.